Hello everyone and welcome. My name is Dr. Glenn Fox and let's talk about the duodenum. In this video, we'll discuss the basic structure, features, and orientation of the duodenum. The duodenum is a C-shaped organ which is preceded by the stomach and succeeded by the jejunum of the small intestine. In fact, the duodenum is the first part of the small intestine. The duodenum consists of four parts. These are numerically enumerated and named, and they can also be named by their relative positions. So for instance, the first part of the duodenum is contiguous with the pyloric part of the stomach. If you recall, the L1 vertebral level is at the transpyloric plane, and that is the level at which the pylorus is going to feed into the duodenum. So the stomach is going to eject chyme into the duodenum for further chemical digestion and absorption. The first part of the duodenum, or the superior part of the duodenum, is relatively short. It's about 5 centimeters. The first part of the first part, so the first half, is intraperitoneal, as is the stomach is intraperitoneal, and it transitions into a secondarily retroperitoneal, meaning it is behind the peritoneum, and it is drawn behind the peritoneum as part of its development. The first part of the duodenum is relatively unique from the remainder of the duodenum in that it is smooth-walled, meaning that there aren't circular folds or plicae circularis, which are common throughout the remainder of the duodenum. The second part of the duodenum here is also known as the descending part. Its orientation is vertical, and it is highlighted by having 2 duodenal papillae, as well as, for the first time, plicae circularis, or circular folds. The duodenal papillae are eruptions of the mucosa through which secretions of the liver and gallbladder, as well as the pancreas, are going to enter into the gut tube. There is a major duodenal papilla. The major duodenal papilla is the distal of the two. It receives the biliary tree, as well as the main pancreatic duct, the hepatopancreatic ampulla empties through the major duodenal papilla and releases bile as well as pancreatic juice into the lumen for further digestion. The major duodenal papilla is quite a landmark in that it divides the foregut from the midgut. The minor duodenal papilla is typically found proximal to the major duodenal papilla, and if it is present, it is what drains the accessory pancreatic duct. That accessory pancreatic duct drains the head of the pancreas. The circular folds, or the plicae circularis, are very strong circular-shaped eruptions of the mucosa that serve 2 roles. The first is to slow the movement of material through the duodenum, and the second is to increase the total amount of surface area, which allows for greater absorption. At its lowest extent, the second part of the duodenum is at the L3 level and feeds into the third part, also known as the inferior part of the duodenum. It's horizontal. It crosses at the L3 vertebral level, and it is crossed anteriorly by the superior mesenteric vein and superior mesenteric artery. It is also secondarily retroperitoneal. It also has very strong circular folds. And we can see that it's going to be nestled between the superior mesenteric vasculature as well as the aorta and inferior vena cava. The third part feeds into the fourth part of the duodenum, also known as the ascending part. It is also vertically oriented, like the second part. The fourth part is the shortest part of the duodenum. It's about 2.5 to 3 centimeters in length. It is also secondarily retroperitoneal. It also has circular folds. And its apex is supported by the suspensory ligament of the duodenum, also known as the ligament of Treitz. Ligament is likely a misnomer for this structure. It's predominantly composed of smooth muscle tissue. There can also be an accessory muscle to this suspensory ligament made of skeletal muscle that will descend from the right crus of the diaphragm. The suspensory ligament supports the duodeno-jejunal flexure. That's where the fourth part of the duodenum transitions into the jejunum, and is sometimes used synonymously with duodeno-jejunal flexure. It may be of consequence to note that this suspensory ligament is a landmark for categorizing gastrointestinal bleeds. Any bleeds that are proximal to this are upper GI bleeds. Any bleeds which are distal are lower GI bleeds. The duodenum, as a part of the gut tube, nestles about the head of the pancreas. It snuggles it quite well. And so we'll see that the predominance of blood supply to the duodenum will be shared by the head and neck of the pancreas. And so when we think of this area, we can think of the gastroduodenal artery, which is a branch of the common hepatic artery, descending down, and it's going to give rise to the posterior superior pancreatico-duodenal, as well as the anterior superior pancreatico-duodenal artery. And the gastroduodenal will have many small duodenal branches supporting it. There's also the inferior pancreatico-duodenal from the superior mesenteric artery, or the SMA, which is going to have both anterior and posterior branches, which anastomose with the anterior and posterior superior pancreatico-duodenal branches of the gastroduodenal artery. In addition, jejunal arteries, which we can see here, coming off of the left lateral side of the SMA, will also supply blood to the duodenum. In terms of innervation, the autonomic innervation of the duodenum is relatively straightforward. When I think of autonomic innervation, I typically think of the blood supply because those autonomic plexuses follow the vasculature. And this is no exception. So what we have is the predominant blood supply to the duodenum will be from both the celiac and the superior mesenteric plexuses. Keep in mind that these plexuses are supplied by sympathetic fibers from the thoracic splanchnic nerves and parasympathetic fibers from the posterior vagal trunk. These fibers will form a plexus and then will come out through the celiac trunk and the superior mesenteric artery. And the branches which serve the duodenum will have fibers from these plexuses. Referred pain from the duodenum is transmitted along visceral fibers, general visceral fibers that accompany sympathetic fibers. And referred pain from the duodenum is referred to the epigastric region. In terms of the effects of the various portions of the autonomic nervous system on the duodenum, the parasympathetic stimulation is going to stimulate and enhance bowel motility, as well as lead to general vasodilation. So we can think parasympathetic rest and digest. We have a very active duodenum. Sympathetic stimulation will lead to vasoconstriction as well as the inhibition of bowel motility, which would be quite the opposite of rest and digest. So we've discussed the duodenum, its relationship to other viscera, as well as its relationship to the peritoneum, its parts, the features of their parts, its blood supply, and its innervation. This is your summary slide. Thank you for your time.